This week on The Gadget Show.
We settle the biggest gadget debate of them all, Mac or PC. Jason and I fight it out with millions of oranges to decide who makes the best computers. A bizarre idea maybe, but it looks great, it hurt Jason, and it helped us to settle the debate.
And who offers the best package to keep you connected? John goes shopping for the best deal for all your phone, TV, broadband, and mobile needs.
Welcome to The Gadget Show. There are a lot of arguments that rage constantly in the gadget world between manufacturers, across tech forums, and pretty much anywhere else where geeky gadget fans get together. And essentially, most of the arguments come down to a face-off between two products.
Xbox 360 versus PS3.
Yeah, Blu-ray versus HD DVD.
Plasma versus LCD.
And people are still arguing about VHS versus Betamax.
Yeah, but they live in Lincolnshire. And they're on InterCB Radio. Look, I live in Lincolnshire. Don't castigate me for that remark. Anyway, the important thing is that the biggest debate of all, the one that rages on seemingly ad infinitum, is which is the best computer?
Of course, we're talking about the battle between these.
Mac.
Versus PC. And it's a battle that's raged on, well, pretty much since the first home computer went on sale.
Absolutely. I mean, for years, I have been firmly in the PC camp, it's fair to say. For me, Macs were overpriced, they were underpowered, and the only argument really in favour of Mac was that they looked nice. That is until, on a whim, I bought a MacBook a few months ago, and I have not looked back. I love this thing. Yes, I love the way it looks, but I also love the way it works. I love the way it works!
Yeah, and don't we just know it. I have been the very happy and contented owner of my Sony Vaio for about 18 months now. I love it, it's perfect for me. But that is not good enough for Jason.
Eh?
Oh no, every time I'm in the office trying to do some work, there he is over my shoulder.
What are you talking about?
Oh, you should get a Mac. A Mac does this. A Mac does that.
No, I do not.
Yes, you do.
I don't.
Yes, you do.
I do not.
Yes, you do.
I don't.
Anyway, it has become clear that Jason and I had ended up on opposite sides of the biggest gadget debate in history.
And so we decided to resolve it by setting ourselves a challenge to finally resolve once and for all which is best, Mac or PC.
And because we were setting the challenge ourselves, we got to choose where we would go. So naturally, we chose
Italy!
Nestled in the hills of northern Italy is the town of Ivrea. Every year, they hold a carnival to celebrate their historic rebellion against an evil landowner.
The highlight of the festival involves a lot of fruit. I'm not going to tell you what they do with it just yet. You'll have to keep watching, but trust me, it's one of the most awesome things I've ever been involved in.
Our mission is to cover the event as reporters and use only our laptops to write stories, edit video, and tweak our photos.
This would really test their usability and capabilities.
But even before the marching bands had started marching, Jason and I had started arguing.
No, we hadn't.
Yes, we had. Oh.
Stop it.
Right, Suze, looking a bit pale.
Am I?
Looking a bit peaky.
Am I?
You got a virus? Oh. Have you got a virus off your PC?
No, I have not.
Because I haven't. I can't get them, all right? Spyware? Oh, it's nowhere. Nowhere.
Yeah, well, I won't get viruses now. With my Vista, loads of security filters. I'll be fine, thank you.
Macs are not more expensive than PCs, all right? It's a load of bunkum. That Vaio you're using right there is exactly the same price as my MacBook, £1,100.
Yeah, fair enough, but this is hardly an entry-level PC, is it? How much can you get an entry-level MacBook for?
OK. There you go, £749.
£749?
Value for money.
Oh, come on, look at this. For your entry-level PC, £320, half that price. I'd like to know, what little bundle do you get with your Mac?
Right, from memory,
yeah.
iWorks.
Yeah.
iLife.
Yeah.
Photo booth.
I love myself.
The Microsoft Office 2004. Oh, full Mac for free.
How long is that for?
30 days.
30 days.
Gratis.
And you think that's a lot?
Mm-hmm.
You think that's a lot?
Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
Well, I think that is a lot. Read them. Oh, wait. Those. All of those. Look. Look how many there are. Shall I read them all out? Could be here for some time.
Just look at what it looks like. I mean, look, this is a good-looking laptop.
Yeah.
I grant you that, OK?
Yeah.
But it's not even in the same design ballpark as this. This is a modern design classic. Let me prove my point. Just bear with me on this one.
What?
Excuse me, do you speak English? Which is the most bellissimo? Mac, get in!
The good people of Ivrea showed some true Italian style and agreed with me, clearly voting the Mac the best looking.
Mac. Yay! Disegno, that or that? Ciao, Bella.
I really hate Italians with their slanty little eyes.
Chase?
So did I say, I meant italics. I hate italics, look.
Okay, so yours is better looking than mine on the outside. Big deal. Look at my gorgeous screen. Look at my beautiful new operating system, Vista.
No, it's good. There's no doubt. It's a great looking operating system, isn't it? Yeah, I love those sort of translucent windows.
It's awesome.
Lovely. And those like widget type things.
Yeah, like those.
You know, it's weird that I can't help thinking that I've seen that somewhere before, you know? Like on my Mac. Yeah, on OS X. Which came first? I think it was this.
Oh, you're so harsh.
Well, you started it.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did. You invaded Poland.
We were in danger of carrying on our argument all day, but we had a challenge to take on.
And as we mentioned earlier, it was a challenge that would involve a hell of a lot of oranges in one of the most bizarre spectacles Europe has to offer. Oh, yeah, and our laptops.
Honestly, you really do need to stick around and see this. I mean, I've never been to a more ridiculous, more fun and more dangerous place all at the same time. And, as I may have mentioned earlier, there's the added bonus of watching Jason being hit a lot with fruit.
And enjoying every last pip of it.
Hello.
Hi, John. Hello.
I've got a Prada phone.
Ooh.
Yes. LG's designers have got together with Prada's designers and produced this, I think, really rather handsome phone.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Touchscreen.
Yeah, it's got a gorgeous touchscreen. It's not just some sort of stupid designer phone. It's actually, it's got lots of really good features, mainly the touchscreen. It's a big widescreen. It's got a good camera. It's got good video. It's got an FM radio.
Wow.
Got everything you'd expect a phone to have, but it actually looks really good.
That, to me, I reckon if you put iPhone on there, people would think it was Apple's new phone, wouldn't they?
It is. I mean, I don't think it's a deliberate rival to the iPhone.
No.
I think it's just coincidental that they've come up at the same time with a very similar sized product.
It's aimed at probably people like me, isn't it? And men that wear slender trousers, like the Italians, because they don't put things in their pockets, because they don't want their trousers to be out of line.
But
how do you know that?
I just know these things. It's time for a short break now, during which you'll probably be watching some adverts, and I shall be pocketing this phone. But we'll be back in no time with more tech.
John will be investigating the BT versus Sky versus Virgin debate. He goes shopping for the best package to provide all his broadband TV and mobile phone needs.
And Susie and I face the onslaught of 5 million oranges as we take part in one of the most bizarre festivals Europe has to offer. All in the interests of testing laptops, you understand.
Last time I looked, I got my TV from Sky, my broadband from Virgin, my mobile from Orange, and my home phone from BT. Different companies for different technologies. That's how it's always worked. Now, though, several of those companies are looking to provide you with all those services wrapped up into tidy media packages. But is that a good thing? Does it make life easier? Does it make life cheaper? Or does it just limit your freedom to chop and change when better deals come along? I decided to investigate whether it's worth signing up for an all-in-one package from Sky, BT or Virgin, or whether you're better off sticking with your separate providers. First, Sky, and in theory they should have the TV side of things locked down. They've got 196 channels and a fine selection of HD material, but for all their top-of-the-range services, you'll be paying £68.50 a month and a £359 start-up fee.
Plus, here in the small print, to actually get their broadband and phone services, you'll need a BT phone line, which is another £11 a month.
Though if you're already a TV subscriber, it's only a tenner a month for unlimited up to 16 megabyte broadband, though they only have half the population covered at the moment.
Let's see on their website whether my phone number, my BT line, actually qualifies. No. Doesn't. Never mind.
The cheapest package Sky offers is £15, which once you add in your line rental totals a still impressive £26. They don't offer a mobile phone service, but you do get 59 digital channels, free evening and weekend calls, and 2 MB broadband with a 2 GB monthly usage cap.
2 GB, that's enough for about 40 downloaded albums. So it's not great if you want to download lots of TV, but if you prefer to do your channel surfing from the sofa, it's a good deal.
Virgin are the new kids on the entertainment block. Well, actually, they're not so new. They're a rebrand of NTL and Telewest, companies with an established cable reputation. So it's not as though you're signing up for the unknown. In fact, Virgin have already started improving the service by ironing out some of the bugs in the notoriously clunky set-top boxes. Virgin don't offer as many channels or as much HD content as Sky. And in fact, they no longer show the basic Sky channels due to a disagreement with the company. But they've got lots of free on-demand programmes.
The phone medium, it's a Talk Weekends package, which is unlimited weekend calls to local and national UK landlines.
Mm.
You do get competitive mobile call rates as well.
Right.
Not that competitive. Calls to some networks can cost you over 30p a minute.
Shall I take a brief shot? Yes, brilliant. Very good.
All right.
Cheers, thank you. Well, if you are after absolutely everything, TV, broadband, phone and mobile, it seems Virgin are happy to oblige, and at a fairly reasonable price. I particularly like the bundles, the 2 for £20, 3 for £30, and especially this 4 for £40, which gives you a TV package with lots of channels, unlimited landline calls at weekends, a 2 MB unlimited broadband, and a mobile SIM card that gives you 300 texts and 300 minutes a month. And if you don't like the bundle, you can actually customise it as well to buy various upgrades.
Over 16 million of us here in the UK have a BT landline. And now BT are planning to build on this impressive bridgehead by launching a full-on attack involving TV, phone, broadband and mobile. I went online to chat to one of BT's broadband specialists.
I'm just asking Amir what the best entry-level package is for broadband, phone and TV. So what's the least I can spend to get all those three options? My BT product specialist is typing a message. This is fun.
He's come back and he said at the moment we don't have a combined package. However, the basic line rental is just £11 a month. The basic broadband is £9.95 for the first 6 months, although £17.99 thereafter. And for the moment, for the TV, I've got to register my interest at bt.com/vision, and somebody will be in touch with me to confirm prices.
That £17.99 doesn't include the home hub that you'll need to get BT Vision. For that, you'll need to pay a higher startup fee or get a more expensive broadband package. Most of the telly on BT Vision is via Freeview. They give you a set-top box with a hard drive for recording as part of the deal. On top of the Freeview channels, they'll send over 1,000 hours of on-demand content via your broadband. And how much is it? From 79p a programme.
Oh, what a swizz.
So, with on-demand costs and one-off fees, you'll soon be bumping up the basic subscription of £29 a month.
Wow, what a quagmire.
It's certainly difficult, but I suppose you only have to work it out once unless you wanted to switch.
I guess we can make it easier by a third, at least, by saying that while the BT system is probably going to offer some really exciting stuff in the future, it's not available yet.
Well, it is available, but we can't actually recommend it yet because they seem very unwilling to supply us with a working example.
We can't.
Can't really recommend it.
No, we can't.
Think. So that leaves us with Telewest. Virgin.
Yeah.
And Sky.
So I'm a big fan of the Virgin box, as you know. I've had the previous iterant, the Telewest box. And you know, my first experience of high definition was through this box.
Although their HD content is still more limited than Sky's.
Yes.
But they are the only people to offer real packages as such, I think, which include everything, all four technologies. Having said that,
if you are already a Sky subscriber and you're in the right area.
And a lot of people are.
Their broadband deals are fantastically good.
So you want a phone, you maybe even want a mobile phone, you want broadband and you want TV content. Which of the three are you going to go for?
Well, I think it's too early to recommend BT. Virgin have the best packages, but Sky a great value if you're in the right area for their broadband.
Some of my friends live abroad. I make a lot of my calls over the internet using Skype. I'm a huge, huge fan. And recently, we've been having a little bit of fun with some software that I downloaded from the net called the Kish Kish Lie Detector. Now, you can only use it with Skype, but it is a lot of fun. Basically, what it does is it measures the stress levels within your voice, because research shows that when you tell a lie, the frequency of your voice changes. So when you're talking normally and you're telling the truth, it tends to be quite low. But if you're telling a lie, the frequency gets much higher. The Kish Kish interface is slightly reminiscent of a polygraph, and you've got the peaks and the troughs. I'm going to ring Jace, who's only at the other end of the studio, but he's got Skype on his phone and it only works with Skype. So let's call him.
Hello, Zap.
Hi.
Just joking. Hi, Susie, you all right?
Yeah, could you just tell me about your breakfast?
Yes, I got up in the hotel, had breakfast in bed actually, which was rather nice.
Firstly, the software has to calibrate Jason's voice to determine his normal stress level.
And some tea.
Now, we know that Kish Kish has got the normal levels of his voice, and so far, according to Kish Kish, he hasn't told any lies. So I'm going to ask him some questions. Jason, is it true that your name is Jason Alan Bradbury?
Yeah, that is correct. I'm named after my uncle Alan and my auntie Jason.
See? Did you see that? It's gone right up there, it's really peaked, and the red light came on, so we know that he's not named after his auntie. Is it true that you are a presenter on The Gadget Show?
Yeah, that's true, although my previous career, as many people know, was a male gigolo, and so I left behind my gigolo status in order to do the Gadget Show.
Yeah, clearly Jason was lying there, and again, it showed very clearly you got the red light and it peaked right at the top of the graph. Here's another one for you then, Jace. I read in the newspaper this morning that you're opening your own milliners. You're going to be designing hats. You've got a new line out, is that correct?
Yep, I'm glad you said hats, because I didn't actually know what a milliner's was. But no, nevertheless, I have opened a chain of men's hatwear, flat caps and basic workwear. My caps look fashionable, but I'll tell you this much, they're safe. They're made of Kevlar and bulletproof clothing
Stop
material.
Stop lying! You're telling me lies.
I'm
You're
lying.
Completely telling me porcupines. Anyway,
hey, does it work? Does it work, then?
It does work, and I just thought Brilliant. I'd like to share that with you, because I've been having a lot of fun with my mates, and as soon as they get stressed, that red light comes on and the graph hits the top. I think it's great.
Right, now it's time to continue with this week's challenge. If you'll recall, we were trying to answer the question, which is best, Mac or PC?
Jace is firmly in the Mac camp, and I am still sold on PCs.
Now, we're focusing on laptops because right now that's, you know, intellectually speaking, where the debate is most hotly contended.
And on a practical level, Jace has got a MacBook and I've got a Sony
yeah,
Vaio.
There is that.
So remember then, we were in a small town called Ivrea in Italy, trying to settle this raging debate.
We wanted to devise a challenge for our laptops that would push them to the max.
So, for the next 24 hours, we're going to be reporters. We've got to write and file a report, take photographs, edit video, and then upload the whole lot to the web.
All we can use are our laptops and the software that came with them and a camcorder.
Sounds like a tall order, but it's even taller when you consider what we're reporting on.
We'll be compiling our reports about the Carnevale dei Ivrea.
Sounds very pleasant, doesn't it? Except this carnival has a violent side. A fruit-based violent side.
Of the festival is a mass fight in which thousands of people attack each other repeatedly, throwing millions and millions of oranges.
We'll compile our reports after the fight. First, we've got to take our photos and shoot our video in glorious HD.
Well, Jason's decided to get in the thick of it I found myself a very nice place up here, very safe, and I think behind this netting it's perfect bird's eye view.
Let's get in there, man.
Jesus. This is insane, man.
My cool red hat, traditional peasant wear, guaranteed me access to the thick of the action. Unfortunately, I got so caught up in the battle that I forgot I had to film the event. Although my footage did have a certain thick of the action quality.
Ah! Oh, yes! This is scary, man!
Now, you may remember a few weeks ago that I fell off a mountain bike on a challenge and I hurt my knee, so I was playing it safe. But despite my injury and the beautiful overview I was getting, it looked like so much fun in the square that I just had to head down.
Right, Suze.
Yeah.
There's another batch of evil landowners coming this way.
Okay.
Wanna go and get a bit of a peasant payback, all right?
Freedom.
Ah. Oh, I've got to take some stills. I want to get some squashed oranges. I've got to be quick, though.
I needed at least three pictures for the report. So I got in and I got out sharpish. The oranges had started to fly thick and fast, so I hobbled to the safety of the surrounding netting.
I made my way forwards over the thousands of squashed oranges that littered the floor. I was determined to get some footage from the very front line.
Over 5 million oranges are thrown at this festival, so the chances are, wherever you are, you'll get hit eventually.
That's the closest I'm getting.
I'd been filming for over an hour, and I was exhausted. Unbelievably, though, we weren't even halfway through. Only 10 of the day's 30 wagons had passed through the square.
Ow! Jesus, right in the Adam's apple!
As the day wore on, I kept getting hit by oranges. If you ask me, it was taking the piff.
Finally, after 2 hours of filming and throwing, we'd got enough photos and footage to compile our reports. It may not look like it, but this wasn't just an excuse to go to Italy. This was a race against time, and we had some serious laptop testing to do.
Wasn't that awesome?
Yeah.
Hardcore. I did feel bad for it. Let me just tell you, because Susie won't tell you this, that she hurt her knee and had stitches in it a few weeks ago because of another challenge involving mountain bikes.
Yeah, he pushed me off a mountain
That's
bike.
That's true. And so she wasn't actually allowed to go anywhere near the action. And you were annoyed, weren't you?
Yes.
Yeah, but we did enjoy it, nevertheless.
No, it was amazing. Absolutely. What a ridiculous carnival to have.
It would never happen
in
England.
Fantastic. What was funny was, I think, that everybody was walking around with black eyes, you know, and broken noses and this, that, but all smiling.
Oh, it was awesome. OK, but of course we were there to test laptops, OK, from the orange war zone, to try and find out, you know, which is best, a Mac or a PC, doing tasks when you're away from home.
Yeah, exactly. You know, word processing, playing with photographs, video editing, and, of course, getting on the internet.
So, find out later what happened when we tried to file our reports of the Carnivale di Ivrea. Let me need to work on my accent. And I'll tell you now that one of the laptops comes out streaks ahead of the other.
Yep, but right now it's time for the critical list. Every week on The Critical List, we look at what's best in a certain area of gadgetry.
Normally, we do it in the studio. We each bring along a gadget and try and outdo each other. But this week, it's a little bit different.
You see, when we were in Italy at the Orange Throwing Festival, we suddenly realised that we were completely surrounded by raw materials that were ripe for testing one particular type of gadget.
So, this week's Critical List is all about juicers.
Right, what we've got here are three of the daddies of the domestic juice world. In fact, they're so good that they are used in bars and cafes. Let's start. Are you ready? Hello.
Yeah. Sorry about
with
that.
This one on the end here. You just ruined your pyramid.
All
this
right.
is the Remida. Stainless steel casing, right? Okay.
Nice.
It's based on the old tradition, you know, where you put your orange in and pull it down.
Yeah.
Same kind of thing, but inside here, you've got a centrifugal force and it goes at 1400 RPM. Right, are you ready? Switch it on. So you just pop it in there, pull down the top.
Nice, nice arc. Nice juice arc. Don't get much out of it, do you?
Well, doesn't seem like a very...
Oh!
Not much, though.
Oh!
Would you switch it off?
This is great fun.
Shall we move on to the next one?
No, but they never said about this in the instructions. If you open it while it's on, get all your mates round, you'll wear, like, helmets and stuff.
Yeah.
It's great fun. Ready?
I think it looks really cool.
Fantastic.
I want to try the orange juice.
Yeah.
OK, let's have a little go. Look at the colour. Quite a strong
colour.
Nice.
It's got a little mixture of blood. I think it's my blood, actually, from that first one.
It's nice. Oh, beautiful.
Very nice. Let's move on to juicer number two.
Can we?
Yep. This is the equivalent of a boy racer's car when it comes to being tricked out as a juicer.
Why?
OK, that blade there, solid stainless steel, connected to a 12-point motor coupling, OK, that delivers the power of this 2-horsepower engine straight to the blades.
2 horsepower?
2 horsepowers, honey. Ever wondered why this blender jug, yeah, and lots like it, which you've probably seen in cafes all over the world,
yeah,
are square and not round? Ever wondered that?
No, but I'm wondering it now.
OK, it's because if they're round... All right, if they're round, when you do this, all they do is spin round. If you don't chop them, if it's square, they get caught in the corners and they get completely mushed. Why is my orange juice brown?
Let's have a look. It's not brown, it's just lighter because you've got all the pith. But do you know, if you leave the pith, that's got more vitamins and nutrients than any other part of the orange. I'll taste it.
How's it taste?
Good, but really different though. To this one.
I'm not sure I like that, you know.
Okay, are you ready for the daddy of them all?
I am, yeah.
Okay, right, this is the Champion 2000.
Okay.
All right, have a look at this.
Yeah.
This blade here, right, takes out all the pulp and it comes out the side. So you can make large quantities without stopping to clean it all the time.
It's got like little teeth on it.
Little teeth, and it's because it's a masticator.
I beg your pardon?
It means that it chews it. And you're left with more nutrients, supposedly.
Fantastic.
Within, yeah.
Should we try it?
Yeah, let's have a go. Pop some in. So the pulp should come out here, and then the juice comes out the bottom. Be interested to see how much pulp comes out this side.
Yeah, it's not as frothy as the middle one.
It's half a horsepower. Look at that.
Bit more?
No, switch it off. Let's have a look. All right, let's try some. That looks more like carrot juice. Look at the colour difference.
But these oranges, locally sourced here in Northern Italy, are a lot redder than we're used
to. They're like blood oranges. Mm. Right, I think that is the best tasting juice that we've got out of the three. And if you just change the juicing plate underneath here for this one, blank one, you can make ice cream, fruit puree, or that sort of stuff. Really good. So it's, I like it because you can do lots of different things, and I just think it tastes great.
Now, because John wasn't with us in Italy, we're going to ask him to do a blind test on the different orange juices. So should we start with this one?
Okay, yeah.
Right. Okay, here's your first one, John. You ready? Mm,
yeah. You've got to smell everything, haven't you, when you're tasting it?
Yeah.
He thinks he's doing a wine test. Ooh,
I know he does, doesn't he?
Ooh, yeah. Ooh, it tastes quite bitter. Lots of bits.
Nice.
Lots of bits. Okay.
Nice bits. Well, I think pretty.
Okay.
Next one up, John.
Number two. Slightly more aromatic.
Have you got any yet?
No.
Okay. Last one.
So number three.
That's more like it, isn't it?
Oh, velvety.
Oh, lovely. Mm.
And tasty as well.
Fascinating watching them work, isn't it?
All right. Probably take your blindfold off.
Yeah, let's do it. I'll take that from you.
That's lovely.
That's from the Champion 2000, which Jason and I both like the best in Italy as well.
Which would you say was your second choice?
Whatever one I had first.
That was from the Romida, which is this sort of old-fashioned pull-down squash orange
juice. It's got lots of bits in it.
That was our second choice as well.
Absolutely, and then this one you...
The one that was... Look, you can't watch... Look. How can you do that? That's remarkable!
Confidently pour it over...
Flip, oh, yes! Right, it's now time to return to this week's challenge.
You may remember that we're trying to resolve an argument between Jason and I as to which is the best computer to buy, a Mac, like what he's got.
Or a PC, like what she's got.
To decide our dispute, we took our laptops to Italy and we set ourselves the challenge of being news reporters for the day. And we reported on a massive orange-throwing festival that takes place in a town called Ivrea.
So, we rejoin the story with the orange fight over and Susie and I racing to complete our reports and upload them to the web.
The rules of the challenge, rules we'd actually made up ourselves, said that we each had to write a 300-word article about the carnival with three accompanying pictures
and edit a two-minute film showing our experiences.
And the first person to post their reports on the Gadget Show website would be the winner.
We both started with our written reports.
These days, there's nothing to choose between Macs and PCs when it comes to word processing.
How many words, Suze?
I'm not telling you.
Developed for PCs, Microsoft Word is the world standard for the written word. You even get a free trial version of it packaged with new Macs.
Is that annoying?
Once your free trial is over, then it's time to buy. And that can be pricey, nearly £200.
What are you doing?
Don't worry though, you don't need to pay that. You can download an open source program like OpenOffice for PC or NeoOffice for Mac. They include virtually identical word processors to Word, and brilliantly, they're completely free.
Why don't you get on, yeah? You do realise that this never stops, you know? Would you do this to Shakespeare?
But the challenge is all...
Would you say, oh, excuse me, William, excuse me, and he'd just go, oh, my God, I'm trying to write a play.
Am I stuffing him?
How am I supposed to focus on my iambic pentameter when I've got you narrowing on? Let me get on.
Using the same word processor on both machines, we were unsurprisingly neck and neck and finished our articles at virtually the same time.
Articles finished, it was photo time, and this is where we should start to see a difference between PC and Mac.
Both laptops had photo processing software packaged with them, but that was where the similarities ended. The iLife package of media software on my Mac contains iPhoto for organising and editing photos. With this, everything I could possibly want to do is just a click or two away. I can crop, reduce red eye, change colours or blur the background really simply.
The whole philosophy of the Mac, is about taking very complex actions like importing images and cropping them and applying effects and so on, and making it absolutely straightforward, as easy as making a cup of tea, so that anyone in the family can grab the machine and do it. Obviously, what you lose in doing that are the kind of effects that I reckon Susie's probably got at her disposal, and the kind of professional level editing tools that she's got. But, you know, if all you're into is this kind of idea of blogging and kind of citizen journalism and getting your stuff out there on the web, this is absolutely ideal.
I've got Adobe Photoshop Elements, a cut-down version of the £600 professional package, and it does have loads of features. I can do things like cut round an image using a magnetic lasso, or create multi-layered collages, for instance. The problem is, though, it's not that easy to get into, and even simple tasks are hidden behind a few menus.
Because iPhoto was so easy to use, I finished my photos first and moved on to the next test.
Well, I spent another 10 minutes putting the finishing touches to my photos. Now the race was on. We had to edit a short movie about our carnival experience, upload it to the Gadget Show website, and whoever got there first would be the winner.
Both computers have free video editing software included, and both automatically recognised our cameras and imported our footage.
My new Vista version of Windows Movie Maker recognised high-def footage, which was good because I'd shot everything in 1080i HDV. With the click of a couple of buttons, you can import photos and music from other parts of your computer quite easily. The only problem with the new Movie Maker is that it's not actually that easy to edit with. I'd drop some footage in, try and move it around, and everything would freeze, which is incredibly frustrating and a complete waste of time.
Editing with iMovie, my Mac editing package, is fantastic. It's so simple to use. Like Movie Maker, you drag and drop clips into the timeline. And it's even easier to get photos and music into your project, as they're all stored in other parts of the iLife program. How it beats Movie Maker hands down for me is it just works. Everything most people would want it to do, it does.
This footage shows you what it must have been like during the medieval revolt.
Using the built-in microphone, I can even record a voiceover with the touch of a button. It's this Mac ethos of everything working and working together that means I cut my two-minute film really, really quickly. And Susie...
I will admit to having a mild panic now because I'm at the stage where I can't find my footage. It just seems to be very convoluted the way you're supposed to edit this piece. We're under time pressure. I know he's almost finished his on his Mac, and I'm lost, quite frankly.
Finished!
You are joking, aren't you?
No, why?
What, you've done the video?
Yeah.
And you've done the report and the photographs?
All of them, and uploaded them all to the internet. Where are you?
Well, I'm still editing my video. I've still got big chunks of it, and I've got no voiceover on it yet. I kind of know what I want to do, but it's so hard to run. I want to edit them down and make it look really cool.
I've got a way you can finish.
How?
Brought my Mac.
Yay! You know what? I'm amazed at how quick you could do everything and how much easier it was to use that Mac for that kind of stuff. Yeah, I'm amazed at that.
I've got to be honest with you. Obviously, I'm going to say, yeah, I told you so. But even I was surprised at how quick and efficient the Mac was. And you know, to be fair, the PC really let you down, didn't it? But I think it's like, you know, the Michelin Web advert on the Apple site, you know, where they essentially say that the PC was designed for word processing in an office environment, whereas the Mac was designed to do stuff at home, the kind of tasks that you do with a computer at home.
I'm not actually annoyed for once
really?
That I've lost the challenge, but I am annoyed that I didn't have the Mac for this challenge.
Well, you know what, Sue?
Don't even start. If you're going to start with the whole, I told you so that I had to listen to all the way back from Italy, I'm going to have to bury you alive in a big pile of suffocating oranges.
Susan,
in fact, I'm going to start right now.
Honestly, you need to buy a Mac. It's as simple as that.
Shut up, Jason.
Do you know when she gets angry, her nostrils go out?
Shut up.
Hello. Hello, I'm Susie Perry.
Ow, stop it.
We'll be right back.